So in this second micro lecture, we will be covering the classical dive response. And I named the classical dive response after two scientists, Lawrence Irving and Per Scholander. You have them up here. And all these studies, the classical diving studies, were done in this type of scenario. In this type of scenario, you have a bathtub with water and then an animal strapped to a board and synced into this bathtub. We're talking about experiments done before and slightly after the Second World War. Something that horrifies us today was actually instrumental in making it possible for many soldiers to actually go and dive safer during that period. Of course, nowadays no one would do these experiments, they would never be approved. Nevertheless, these experiments gave us a lot of knowledge and understanding of what we have now decided to call the classical dive response. Later on, I will tell you how this classical dive response changes or is different from the field dive response. But let's look at the mechanisms of the classical dive response because they illustrate this rather well. The classical dive response of Irving and Scholander is basically present in all birds and mammals, and it's better developed in diving animals. The classical diving response is actually consisting of three factors, or three responses. Apnea, of course, absence of breathing. Bradycardia, a lowering of the heart rate. And peripheral vasoconstriction, constriction of the blood vessels in the periphery. They are also, the classical diving response is also characterized by increased anaerobic metabolism and the production of lactate. And here you have some examples from actually pictures that are posted. Oh, this is on a bird. This is on some sort of porpoise. Oh no, this is a seal. This is a seal actually. The classical dive response basically has the purpose of metering out oxygen to the most essential organs while minimizing cardiac expenditure. So the idea of animals developing or undergoing this classical dive response is to make the best use out of the oxygen you have available. Make the oxygen available to those organs that will need it most, and those organs that will need it less, basically give them less oxygen. What are the elements of this classical dive response, which is actually a reflex response? First of all, a slowing of the heart rate, the bradycardia. Reduction in cardiac output also drops. Peripheral vasoconstriction in muscles, viscera, and skin. So certain organs, the muscle, the viscera, the internal organs, and the skin will receive less blood because of the peripheral vasoconstriction. There is going to be an increase in blood pressure. There is an increased brain and myocardial blood flow. These are the two organs that are actually prioritized, heart and brain. These are the organs that, although cardiac output decreases, will get most of the blood flow. You have also increased hematocrit, the percent of red blood cells in the blood, by a splenic contraction. The spleen is an organ that stores red blood cells, and then in the dive response, basically can release these red blood cells into the circulation. You have an increased anaerobic metabolism, and you have also preserved oxygen delivery and carbon dioxide removal in the brain and the heart. These are the elements of the classical, the diving reflex response. And we'll see now how it takes place. What are the stimuli that trigger this diving response? Of course, apneic submersion, that means that you stop breathing and go underwater. But apnea alone will also do this. If you decide to hold your breath, but you're not in the water, there will also be a reflex diving response. If you immerse the face in cold water, with or without apnea, so that means immersion of the face in water, while continue breathing or not, you can continue breathing through a snorkel, for example, and then you'll see that to some extent the diving response is still triggered. Or you can even cool the face. So there are many different stimuli that actually trigger the response. And that's because we know that this diving response is actually triggered by stimulating different parts in the face, mostly the ones that are innervated by the ophthalmic nerve. The most pronounced bradycardia, if we look at heart rate response, is the result of breath holding and chilling of the forehead and the eye region. So if you want to get the strongest bradycardia, you would hold your breath and you would cool down this part. Cooling down this part and holding your breath will show you the largest bradycardia. And again, these are regions innervated by the trigeminal nerves, in particular the ophthalmic nerve. This is the data that actually supports this. What you have here is how does the heart rate change, from a 100% value when you stimulate different regions in the face. And just to look at what is the one that triggers the largest response is actually the F, the stimulation of the forehead. The stimulation of the forehead drops heart rate down to 85%. Trying to figure out what this one is, but I cannot see it here. But it doesn't matter. I mean, basically, this is the region that actually triggers the largest bradycardic responses. If you now look at a graph of apneic time, the time of apnea, versus the reduction in heart rate, what you see is a good correlation in it. The larger decrease in heart rate, the larger the decrease in heart rate, the longer the time of apnea. And you have experienced divers at the extreme here that can hold their breath for more than 2 minutes. In them, you see the largest reduction in heart rate by about 40%. Scuba divers, people that do scuba diving, non-divers, sedentary population, AMA divers, actually, interestingly, down here. And this is basically because AMA divers, they do a lot of repeated dives. So in AMA divers don't dive for a very long time. Actually, it's mostly that they do that for several hours a day, just coming up to the surface, back down again. How do we know of the peripheral vasoconstriction in this classical response? Well, one experiment that has been done, and it's properly explained in your textbook as well, actually involved the injection of a contrast fluid in the circulation when forced diving. And if this is basically, this is a sketch of what you're going to see in the next slide. And in this slide, you inject a contrast fluid in the arteries going down to the kidneys. Here you have the two kidneys, and of course the left renal artery. What happens when you are breathing air? Notice that you do an injection, and then this is 0.5 seconds, 2 seconds, and 6 seconds after injection. When you inject this contrast medium, you see which areas are perfused. What area is shown here? The kidney. This is the kidney. And even immediately after 0.5 seconds, you have some blood coming into the kidneys. Now the whole kidney is perfused, and 6 seconds even more. Renal perfusion is apparent. There is perfusion of the kidney. What happens when force diving? This is what happens. This is your renal artery. This is your renal artery. 4 seconds, 14 seconds afterwards. What has happened here? Why don't you see a kidney? Essentially, there is a general or a vasoconstriction at this point, vasoconstriction that prevents blood from going into the kidney. Vasoconstriction is actually explaining that blood is not going to all organs. It's actually preferentially sent to the brain, to the heart, and not to the viscera, not to the kidneys, not to the skin, not to the muscles. Incidentally, you may want to think, well, what happens for an animal that goes diving if there is no blood to the muscles, right? That's something we will talk in a second about. But remember, this is forced diving. This is a forced diving in which the animal is strapped to a board and then sinked into a bathtub. Peripheral vasoconstriction has two purposes. The first one is to actually maintain blood pressure. Why maintain blood pressure? Remember, bradycardia, heart rate goes down, right? What happens with cardiac output? Heart rate goes down, cardiac output goes down. If cardiac output goes down, blood pressure would go down as well, because now you're sending less. How do you compensate for this drop in cardiac output? By increasing resistance, by actually increasing peripheral vasoconstriction. With peripheral vasoconstriction, you increase resistance, and despite the drop in cardiac output, you have no change in blood pressure. So the peripheral vasoconstriction, the main point of peripheral vasoconstriction is to actually prevent a drop in blood pressure. The second purpose is what I just said. The second purpose is to actually send the blood to those organs that are relevant and not to those that in that condition are not going to be perfused. Mm-hmm. Keep that in mind. Two purposes for the peripheral vasoconstriction. Mm-hmm. What you see in this picture is actually evidence of this change in the perfusion patterns. You have a cardiac output drop, bradycardia, cardiac output. What we can see is basically a reduction in finger and forearm blood flow. In the arm, there is peripheral vasoconstriction, there is less blood flowing going in there. What happens with the carotid artery? The carotid artery data is actually shown here. Before breath hold at 30 seconds, at 40 seconds, in different conditions. But let's compare with submersion to 40 meters of depth. What you notice here is that the blood flow into the carotid artery increases by about three times compared with breath holding. The carotid artery is the artery that brings blood flow into the brain, remember? So what this is showing is that despite the cardiac output change, despite the peripheral vasoconstriction, brain blood flow is maintained. This has also been studied in seals. And what you see here is a graph that shows you the blood flow before, in the control conditions, and during diving. In different parts, in the brain cortex, in the cerebellum, in the retina, in the lung, in the heart, atrial and ventricle, in the diaphragm, pancreas, liver, and psoas muscle. So essentially what this shows, the data in this Wevel seal shows, is that there is a decrease in all organs, a bit less so in the lung, except for the brain. The brain is spared, all other organs have a decrease in blood flow. And this is basically a summary scheme of what's going on during these conditions, of the reflex or the diving reflex response, the classical diving reflex response. Mm-hmm. This is basically long. I'm going to make it rather simplistic and short. Upon apnea and submersion, there is essentially stimulation of the face through the trigeminal nerve, which will target the vagal nerve to decrease heart rate. There is a decreased heart rate, and as a result of that, there is a decreased cardiac output. Mm-hmm. At the same time, this decrease in cardiac output would drop blood pressure if it was not because the vasomotor tone, the peripheral vasoconstriction, increases. And that means that the blood pressure is preserved, and you have a preferential perfusion of the heart and the brain. The brain is here, the heart is just over there. And that's basically what explains breath holding for the time that it actually takes place. That's the end of these lectures, and time for questions now.